The year was 1963, just in the midst of the Soviet and American space race, and people were more excited to explore the outside world than ever before. Ohio State University was ready to begin the initiation of one of their latest and most ambitious projects, the Big Ear, a telescope designed for examining interstellar radio sources for the Ohio Sky Survey. It was quite an advanced piece of technology for its time, and could be used to determine whether a signal came from a star, galaxy, comet, or just about any other celestial object capable of emitting radio waves. Despite the Big Ear's capabilities, there was just one thing that people could not understand. Where's the aliens? We did collect over 20,000 different signals for the sky survey, but nothing groundbreakingly out of the ordinary. Nothing that could suggest that there are other life forms out there doing the exact same thing as us. The search for extraterrestrial intelligence, also known as SETI, recognized the potential that this telescope had. Rather than simply detecting and recording previously unknown galaxies and quasars, it could also detect possible alien life. When the Ohio Sky Survey mission was completed, United States Congress voted to cut funds for the project in 1971. As a result, the telescope was repurposed by SETI to exclusively search for extraterrestrial life. It would be about 6 years before things really got interesting. On August 18, 1977, astronomer Jerry Ehman was doing his usual routine of looking through the printouts of the most recent computer records generated by the Big Ear. His job was to essentially look for any strange activity the telescope recorded. Most of the papers typically just documented background noise, until a recording from 3 days prior grabbed his attention, particularly this spot on the paper. This wasn't just noteworthy, it was astonishing. So much so that Ehman circled the spot and wrote the word "wow" right next to it, and consequently, it was named the Wow Signal. If you have done some light researching on the Wow Signal before, you may have come across this particular YouTube video showcasing the actual sound that was captured on that day. But what happens when you speed it up? These are indeed voices that you are hearing, but they are not nearly that old. This is none other than an audio sample of the Delta Airlines Flight 191 plane crash in 1985. Definitely a very clever and well done hoax, but still one that can be easily falsified. When people who are unfamiliar with the story first think of the Wow Signal, they typically do imagine some strange audio transmission that came to Earth that astronomers were trying to decipher. Although a common misconception, this is actually not the case. The Wow Signal was literally none other than just a bunch of letters and numbers on a piece of paper. This may not sound that exciting, but it is actually much more significant than you might think. In order to fully understand just how strange the signal actually is, we first need to understand how to actually read the signals themselves. This is the kind of printout that you would usually be presented with when going through the Big Ear's findings. These long lists of numbers on the right here are coordinates and timestamps, telling you the exact place in the sky and time of where the signal was found. Each of these rows were divided out into 12-second increments. These numbers on the left represent the frequency that the data was found on. This data is read vertically and numbered based on the signal's strength, with a 1 being very low and numbers like 5 or 6 and up being quite high and more unusual. If numbers exceeded 9, 10 and so on would be represented with the alphabet. This would explain why this paper is mostly filled with 1s and 2s, the feedback generated from the presence of background noise. But as you go towards the bottom, you see this particular string. 6EQUJ5. At its peak, this signal was 30 times greater than what was typically recorded on paper. If we wanted to replicate this signal, we would need something 1,000 times stronger than the current strongest radio transmitter on Earth. It is no wonder that Ehman was absolutely blown away when he saw this. The signal came from the M55 cluster near the constellation of Sagittarius, about 17,000 light-years away from us. It only lasted for 72 seconds, so when Ehman and other astronomers pointed the telescope back at the spot where it came from, they were never able to find it again. Amazingly enough, the strangest thing about the WOW signal is not actually the signal itself, but the particular frequency that it was found on, 1420 megahertz. This is the same frequency that is naturally emitted by hydrogen. Why is this important? In 1959, Cornell University physicist Philip Morrison and Giuseppe Cocconi suggested that the possibility any alien life would try to communicate to us through the same frequency as the most abundant element in the observable universe is incredibly high. In other words, the fact that this signal was found on 1420 megahertz and 1420 megahertz only basically screams that it was sent by extraterrestrial intelligence. Though how do we know that this frequency wasn't just intercepted by, say, a group of teenagers trying to play some kind of practical joke? Well, scientists are so confident that aliens would use this frequency to communicate with us that any use of the hydrogen line is actually banned under international law, and thus unavailable for use. For over 40 years, what happened on that day has remained to be one of science's greatest mysteries. So, was it aliens? No one has ever been able to conclusively identify what this signal exactly was. There are quite a few theories that could explain it though, but none that couldn't be counter-argued. One possibility dictates that the Big Ear simply came across a quasar, galaxy, or some kind of space object that emitted a much stronger radio wave than usual. Though this is not likely the case, because these kinds of emissions are continuous. If Ehman were to point the telescope back into this area, he should have been able to receive the signal again quite easily, but he didn't. A temporary eruption of energy, such as a gamma ray burst from a supernova, could explain Ehman's inability to relocate it. But the signal didn't exhibit the constant changing in power that we would expect from a supernova emission. Along with this, there was also no space debris left behind that we could observe, which should be present from something as strong as a supernova. One of the most popular theories argues that the signal was the result of a phenomenon known as interstellar scintillation, basically a twinkling of radio information present throughout the atmosphere. Scientists have argued that these twinkles of signals wouldn't last nearly as long as 72 seconds, but others have objected that a signal this long is possible if the source were present in outer space, an area which is much thinner and vaster than the Earth's atmosphere. Though this wouldn't explain why other much more sensitive telescopes, such as New Mexico's VLA, could not also detect the signal, or why these waves were only seen on the hydrogen line. The last resort explanation for this strange signal was that it was simply a computer glitch. This would explain why the Big Ear was the only radio telescope to receive these waves, because they wouldn't have been waves at all. But how this data was presented sort of eliminates this possibility. Rather than behaving like your conventional computer glitch with a sudden jolt in information, this signal was continuous, reached a peak, and eventually drifted away as a telescope moved to other areas of the sky. The idea of a computer glitch following the exact same behavior as a radio wave visible in outer space is just too great of a coincidence. Although in 2017, a possible revelation occurred. Florida scientist Antonio Paris hypothesized that the signal may have come from two comets, 266 P. Christensen and 335 P. Gibbs. Although these comets were undiscovered at the time, Paris argues that they were in the same spot as the M55 cluster when the signal was captured. Most comets, by nature, contain large chunks of water ice, which would eventually melt after long periods of exposure to the sun. This would cause the release of hydrogen gas, which would, of course, be visible on the 1420 MHz frequency. After decades, the mystery behind the WOW signal was finally solved. Right? Well, not exactly. Again, this theory does not take into account why the VLA, along with other telescopes, did not capture the signal too. In addition, there is currently no evidence that comets are capable of emitting radio waves that are this powerful. Even Jerry Ehman himself, along with other members of the Big Ears research team at that time, do not believe that this is the case, and even argue that these comets were not in the location at the time which Paris specified. So many things just didn't add up, and any theory that was proposed seemed to just contradict existing evidence. With that being said, the WOW signal continues to be a mystery that not even science has yet been able to explain, and as a result, is argued to be one of the greatest pieces of evidence for intelligent life to date. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe if you enjoyed this video and would like to see more. Also, check out the links in the description for a more immersive experience.